welfare, and how do we use the networks better to drive economic growth and public policy goals. But there was an additional question that Congress asked us to look at, which was what policies would drive innovation on broadband. And this led to another question, a question that is at the heart of this conference, and a question that both excites and troubles me. And that question is, what happens if we remove bandwidth as a constraint on innovation? The question excites me because, as I learned from a brilliant doctor, genetic sequencing, which uses such massive bandwidth, that it's actually cheaper and faster to send the results by FedEx, can revolutionize medicine. If we eliminate bandwidth constraints, we can improve treatments for, among other maladies, cancer. The question excites me because, as I learned from educators, immersive gaming technology, which requires massive bandwidth, can dramatically increase the effectiveness of education and job training, particularly for those for whom traditional methods fail. The question excites me because, as I learned from a broad spectrum of folks, the coming age of big data has the potential to accelerate advancements in addressing our most vexing problems, but to achieve its full potential, big data needs big bandwidth. The question troubles me for the same reason. The doctor told me he's treating people today who will soon die, but if he had the tools of tomorrow, he could save them. So too, delays in removing bandwidth as a constraint mean that soon a child will grow up illiterate who doesn't have to. A man seeking to retrain for a job of the future will not receive the help he needs. A critical discovery to address climate change could be delayed because we're not collaborating as effectively as we could. There is a big cost to this delay, even if we can't see it, and even if economists can't measure it. So in that light, we should all want to accelerate that moment where only untapped human ingenuity and not bandwidth constrains our progress or our ability to use Wi-Fi in this room. And that's the goal of Gig.U, the group that I organized with about 3 dozen research institutions to create test beds for unlimited bandwidth. And that's why today I'm going to spend my time arguing that the prime mission of communications policy ought to be to eliminate bandwidth as a constraint on innovation and productivity. This is a dramatic change. And in doing so, I'm going to offer 3 assertions that would accelerate, I believe, the next generation of network deployments and services. And that is that first, as the principal activity of our economy and society is knowledge exchange, and as the internet is its commons, the prime purpose of communications policy should be to improve knowledge exchange by delivering a strategic bandwidth advantage and a psychology of abundance. The second is that the current market dynamics in the United States and regulatory structure won't deliver the wireline upgrade necessary to deliver that advantage and abundance. The third is that network upgrades are not only the best way to achieve a strategic bandwidth advantage and psychology of abundance, it's also the best way to achieve the other 4 objectives. And let me just say that I believe that 1 and 3 really apply to every country in the world. They would have to be done differently. Number 2, the market structure in every country of the world, the regulatory dynamics are different. But let's talk about these, starting with the first. So what is it that most of us do with our time? At the heart of our daily efforts, we gather data, we store it, we analyze it, we go through a feedback loop, we adjust behavior, and start that process all over again. The better we do that, the better the outcome. This is not a novel thought. Decades ago, the great business consultant Peter Drucker suggested that the most important contribution that management can make in the 21st century is to increase the productivity of knowledge workers. He went on to say it is on this productivity and that the future prosperity and indeed the future survival of developed economies will depend. It's important to understand that as we talk about this, that knowledge work is not just the province of white collar work. It's not just what we do here in Silicon Valley. It is now part of every sector. And this is before the era of big data multiplies the importance of knowledge exchange. Now, history teaches us many lessons about how we benefit from technology-driven change. One of them is on the importance of combinatorial innovation. For thousands of years, population and food production rose in tandem, which is the British economist Thomas Malthus famously wrote, doomed mankind to a state of mere subsistence and misery. But something got us out of that trap, and that was the Industrial Revolution. And what characterized the advance of science and technology in the Industrial Revolution, as opposed to earlier scientific discoveries in China and Arab countries, was that each advance combined with others to drive growth. And indeed, what you see in this combinatorial innovation is something like the steam engine, which was at the heart of the Industrial Revolution, which was not a single discovery, but rather thousands of them. Now, the history of innovation, Stephen Johnson credits the coffee houses of London with facilitating the exchange of ideas necessary for this combinatorial innovation. And perhaps future historians will credit free Wi-Fi in coffee houses around the world with another generation of that exchange. But there's no doubt that the broadband infrastructure is the primary method by which we exchange information today. A second lesson about technological change is the importance of leadership in the exchange of inputs. A precursor of great advances in an economy is when we exchange one set of inputs with another. We saw it at the beginning of the agricultural age when we replaced human labor with animal labor. We repeated it with the Industrial Revolution when we replaced human and animal-based inputs with coal, iron, trains. We repeated it a century ago by exchanging those inputs with steel, electricity, cars, and planes. And over the last 20 years, we've seen another historic change as we've exchanged input based on atoms with those based on microprocessors, fiber optics, and digitization. And this, of course, has dramatically changed the way we do knowledge exchange, with the ability to store information, analyze that information, and transfer that information. Now, we know that countries that lead in driving and adapting to input changes receive a greater share of the benefits from that change. And thus, every country should want their residents to replace the use of atoms with the use of bits, chips, and bandwidth wherever possible and as soon as possible. The broadband ecosystem brings these two things together. This transformation from bricks to bits has created a world in which the principal activity becomes knowledge exchange and the principal method is over the internet. Now, one way in which this transformation differs from previous ones is how it scales. As former FCC Chairman Reed Hunt has written, it's technically and economically feasible to distribute robust public goods to everyone on the internet, about 3 billion people, and almost everyone in the United States, at a cost that approximates zero. And this opens up all kinds of opportunities as the low marginal costs combined with human creativity to produce the kind of abundance that replaces a short cross-country phone call priced at dollars with a video conferencing call uniting persons on five continents priced at three. This reflects a different kind of wealth creation than we've ever seen. You know, building a fantastic Ferrari benefits the seller and the buyer, but its price reflects its scarcity and its impact is limited. But building a fantastic teaching tool, as Khan Academy, a few miles from here, is doing, can teach millions, and the wealth it creates benefits all. So what are the building blocks to increasing the probability of being both the innovators and the first beneficiaries of innovation? First, I think it is a strategic bandwidth advantage. Think of it this way. 25 years ago, a farmer and a doctor in rural Iowa basically needed the same thing, dial time. Today, their needs are very different. The farmer needs great mobility to be able to connect to critical data while outside and moving around, while the doctor needs great fixed connectivity to, for example, analyze MRIs in real time with experts in large cities. We need a strategy that gets both of them the kind of bandwidth they need, even if it's now different. Throughout the economy, we should have the necessary bandwidth going to the right places to drive productivity and the most effective delivery of essential public services. In addition to getting the bandwidth we need today to increase productivity, we also need to have the talent experienced in designing, building, operating, and innovating on top of the best networks in the world. These networks are always going to be ahead of where the mass market applications are today. And so this is the building blocks for the strategic bandwidth advantage for innovation. functionality in terms of two-way high-definition video and exchange of big data, with the area expertise, which will enable us to invent all kinds of new ways to deliver medicine, education, business services, etc. And it's on those networks we can create, in effect, a Bell Labs 3.0, a community of collaboration brought to us by the parallel experimentation of millions of entrepreneurs, which, as a recent book has demonstrated, is the best and fastest way to drive innovation. Now, that insight on the need for world-leading networks to drive improvements for all led us in the plan to recommend a critical mass that the country needed a way to have a critical mass of communities with world-leading networks, networks that don't just follow demand, but networks that lead demand. So in sum, we should have a goal of having, every country should have a goal of having a strategic bandwidth advantage that delivers what they need to be as productive as possible today and to lead for whatever they feel they should want to lead in tomorrow. The second thing we need is a psychology of bandwidth abundance. We know that big bandwidth drives innovation, investment, and jobs. We saw this in wireless, where it really wasn't until AT&T came out with the OneWeb that consumers adopted a psychology of abundance, and as a result, average minutes went up 5 times. Subscribership and revenues also soared. The same story is true, by the way, for the internet, where AOL was reluctant to do a unlimited package until a combination of competition and policy changes enabled them to do it. Internet usage soared in the United States. It did not in Europe, where they still had per-minute charges. The same story appears more recently with the smartphone. You know, recently, the chairman of AT&T said that unlimited data was a mistake, but he thinks he does apologize too much. As he kind of ironically wrote yesterday in the Wall Street Journal, America has been an enormous beneficiary of the partnership of AT&T and Apple, and it would not have worked had it not been unlimited. In fact, it wasn't a mistake. It was the necessary response to a competitive dynamic in which he fell behind Verizon. And without the unlimited plan, the iPhone would not have succeeded. So in all three cases, the United States benefited from consumers having a psychology of abundance rather than a psychology of scarcity. And as a recent book demonstrated, entrepreneurial activity is more likely to succeed in those environments in which consumers are willing to try unproven products, which they're willing to do if their only cost is time, but not if they pay at an incremental cost. So to sum up, knowledge exchange or principal economic activity benefits from a strategic bandwidth advantage and a psychology of bandwidth abundance, and therefore that should be the prime policy mission, to produce that advantage and psychology. So if that's the mission, will the current market produce it? And again, now in this section, I'll talk about the United States. As a starting place, we ought to aspire to the creation of bandwidth at the same place that Moore's law increases abundance in devices and chips. And we do, as I think Fujitsu demonstrated in the previous video, on the transit side, we're seeing this because due to the progress of fiber optic communications over the period of 25 years, the system capacity has increased about 5 orders of magnitude, which has resulted in a huge decline in transit pricing from about 1,200 bucks per megabit to less than a buck. However, when you look at the United States in terms of the usage of wireline bandwidth, the numbers suggest that we're mid-tier and there is a pattern of decline. And as noted above, if we want to lead, we have to lead in use, not just theoretical access. But let's turn our attention to, as Wayne Gretzky famously said, not where the puck is, but where it's going. And here is a really big fact that nobody in Washington, D.C. apparently wants to recognize. We have deregulated on the basis that there was this competition that would drive increases in consumer welfare and capacity. And to be fair, it did that. It worked. So some of those decisions were very good. But for the first time since the beginning of the commercial internet, we no longer have a national wireline provider with plans to build a better network than the currently best available network. And that means played a number of wireline upgrades, but that poker game is over. Verizon has fundamentally said they're not building out files anywhere else. AT is looking to sell their wireline assets. Recently, Randall Stevenson said that maybe they'll rethink that and upgrade some of their rural, but they're not going to overbuild cable. Cable could upgrade, but why should they upgrade if the telcos aren't pressing them? They simply can't justify the incremental spend. And as a Wall Street analyst recently noted, the numbers, and this is a quote, the numbers suggest that cable broadband is almost comically profitable with direct gross margins of about 97%. No doubt Wall Street has a different view of comedy than Hollywood, but I want to be clear that I'm not criticizing cable for achieving that margin. They invested at great risk. They delivered a platform that is, for today's purposes, fantastic. We shouldn't blame them for succeeding, nor should we blame the telcos for a rational capital allocation strategy. But we should not excuse ourselves about the future. Instead of talking about wireline upgrades, our network providers are talking about caps. Instead of talking about investment for growth, they are talking about harvesting for dividends. And that's the fundamental tension that we need to address. Society needs an upgrade, I believe, but right now in the market there is a dynamic that is all about harvest. And so we need to understand that our society's progress requires an investment environment that creates conditions that allow us to invest for the future and not just harvest from the past. The government should not attempt to micromanage the packaging or pricing of a service. But we need to understand, and we need all policymakers to understand this very clearly, that a country that is talking about an upgrade and not caps will be better off in a few years, guaranteed. A country that is talking about caps and not an upgrade will not be better off in a few years and is probably going to be worse off. Now, it's wrong and I think counterproductive to blame any private sector entity for the situation. Rather, we should seek to understand why don't we see the abundancy in transport reflected in last mile access. In this regard, two equations might be useful. The first is growth and total benefits, and we can see that there are a number of parties that benefit from an upgrade, but fundamentally only one matters, and that's the investment. And for them, the equation looks something like this, is cost versus benefits, or broken down, it's relationship between new and incremental cap, X and OpEx versus the risk-adjusted revenues plus the system benefits plus the threat of competitive losses. Today, the cost side is greater, therefore, no upgrade or new network is in the offing. It's actually worse in the U.S. because we split between two wires, and therefore the math is more problematic. So the question is, how do we deal with that problematic math? It's actually conceptually not that hard. To reverse that relationship between costs and benefits, we need to have an environment which lowers CapEx, OpEx, and risk, and increases revenue, system benefits, and competitive threat. It's easier said than done, but we have done this before. And that leads me to my third point. So here's a chart that I don't know how well you can see it, but this is kind of one of the things about having done this work for the last 20 years is you actually can remember a lot of history. So this is kind of all the upgrades we've ever had. They were all primarily built by private money. But what's interesting about them is that each of the upgrades, or new networks, were preceded by a change in policy that changed the map in one or more of these six categories in the appropriate way. Furthermore, when Gig.U engaged with broadband vendors and service providers in an RFI process, we received lots of suggestions about how other beneficiaries could particularly local communities could change the map. And in fact, these are kind of the playbook of the actions that Kansas City has agreed to do for Google to allow them to invest. It's what state and local officials did in Florida and Maine, where we've recently announced Gig.U projects. It's also the core of what a private company, Gigabit Square, which has said they're going to put $200 million into six Gig.U communities. It's what they are looking for from local communities to change that now. And I might note, it's interesting, Gigabit Squared is effectively doing a private version of Race to the Top for communities that want a gigabit. So we can actually change the math. And indeed, We've learned two very critical lessons in this process. First, any community that wants its residents to have access to a gig can do so. The barrier is not technology or economics, rather it's about organization. How do you organize assets, particularly underutilized assets, and how do you organize demand? The second thing we've learned is that universities are indeed, they have the greatest motive and the easiest organizing task. Big data communities, which university communities tend to be, have the greatest pre-existing demand and high bandwidth enterprises. As they are born, they're more likely to be born there. Now, there are a myriad of policies at the federal, state, and local level that could assist in this mission, but the purpose of my talk is not to catalog the policies, rather it's to sell the primacy of the mission. Because if policymakers ask themselves, as they're looking at options, which option will drive a strategic bandwidth advantage, which option will drive a psychology of consumer abundance, then we will accelerate the day at which we achieve that mission. If we ask the right question, we have a good chance to get it right. If we ask the wrong question, our chances are slim. In fact, our only chance is luck. But there's another reason for this focus, one that's generally misunderstood in the policy arena, which is that as we think about what would be the impact of the upgrade, we would actually, when you look at the history of other upgrades, you actually begin to realize that it's the upgrades themselves that lead to better and easier answers of the other traditional four questions. If we're smart about that mission, then the bandwidth and abundance will get networks everywhere. They will get everybody on. They will generate a competitive dynamic and drive better uses far more effectively than any other means, which is why I hope that next year the President of the United States tells the chair of the FCC that his or her mission is to deliver a strategic bandwidth advantage for the country and a psychology of bandwidth abundance for consumers, and that the country will hold the chair accountable for achieving those goals. Now, on a personal note, I hope it's the same president and the same FCC chair, but my real point is that's a mission which is and ought to remain bipartisan. So let me close with my favorite answer to the question of what happens if we eliminate bandwidth as a constraint on innovation. I start by saying it would simply be enough if we could say we need big bandwidth, and what's really going to be great about it is it's going to accelerate curing that doctor's patient. It's going to help us help an illiterate child to read. It's going to help retrain an unemployed worker. It's going to provide a partner in collaboration with big data and big data science will need. But my favorite answer actually came in the event where we announced the Giga project in May. Many testified eloquently as to the project's importance, but none more than a kid named Nate Wiles, who was a graduating senior, who said that while having the world's fastest network in Maine would enable a business that he had just started to work better and would bring immediate benefits to the state, the most exciting thing about having basically unlimited bandwidth to him was, and I quote, "what we don't know yet." What we don't know yet. And in this regard, Mr. Wiles is following the great American tradition of those who travel with hope, energy, urgency, but no map. In that tradition, whether it be Lewis and Clark, the astronauts, or the fathers of broadband, we don't follow a map, we make a map. And I hope today, in conferences like this to come, we make a map to discover the undiscovered country. Thank you very much.